Hi guys again, and today is the day that I entered Belize. I put it off for a couple of extra days, mainly because the weather across the border, not so much in Chetumal, but in Belize was looking really bad for quite a while. And as you can see here, I've just basically just entered Belize. And I was going to talk a little bit about the border crossing here into Belize. I got stopped immediately and they actually asked me to remove my camera from my helmet, believe it or not. And that's the first time, that was the only time it ever happened. A lot of them would say, is that on? Turn it off. And you just say, yeah, it's off. And just leave it on. Especially with the drift ghost, it blinks red. And so I tell them red is stopped, red is off, you know. But anyway, they told me to take the thing off, or that they'll take it away from me. But anyway, getting through. So the first thing I had to do was, once I got to the border of the Mexican side, I had to go inside and hand in my vehicle permit, import permit, and the FMM tourist card. So with the vehicle permit, I'd already paid a $400 deposit, so I got that back in cash at the border as well. The whole process might have taken me, on the Mexican side, maybe only 15-20 minutes. There wasn't really anyone there waiting. So once I got my passport stamped, then I went across and got my vehicle import permit handed in with the tourist card, and then I went to the booth. They checked my passport, and then I went on. And then they come after you've got your vehicle permit, you've handed that in, you're pretty much on your way. So it didn't take long at all, 15-30 minutes maximum. Entering Belize, the first thing, I mean, I did some reading up beforehand, and the first thing you have to do is you've got to go in and get the fumigation done. And there's a little tiny little house on the right hand side as you're riding up. And it shows you, that's the fumigation booth. It's got a sign with $5 you can see on it. You get the fumigation receipt. The guy's pretty inquisitive guy, asked a few questions about your bike, and then you move on, and then you go, basically, there's quite a large building, and you just park outside the building, go inside, and on the right-hand side, you'll see the building. This is the vehicle import permit for Mexico. And it's a sticker, basically. I never put it on my bike. Yeah, some people say you're supposed to, but they didn't care. So I just left off my bike. And this is when I first entered into Belize, and this is Little Belize. I went on a bit of a detour because there's a couple of little towns along the way. It wasn't supposed to be a long ride, only about 250 kilometers, but the weather moved in pretty quickly, and it became a lot longer day. Only because I had to stop, because I just couldn't see it all. The rain was just so strong. So once I got entered Belize, it's quite a modern building. I parked my bike outside, went inside, and on my right-hand side, I got my passport stamped into Belize, and then I organized my vehicle permit. It didn't take long at all. It took me about 10 minutes. They just put something in the computer. There was no one there, so it was early in the morning. And then they came outside, inspected the vehicle, got my VIN number off my vehicle, and then went back inside and got all the paperwork, and I was done. I was out of there probably 30-40 minutes. And then once you've done that, you go to the booth, you show your passport with your papers, and then they tell you to go on. But you actually have to make one more stop. You've got to go get insurance. And as you're about to go around a corner to the left, there's a big house on the hill there. And what you do is you stop at that house on the hill, and then you go inside and you pay for your insurance. You can pay for, I think the minimum is 2 weeks, so I'm not positive, but I think I paid for 2 weeks, and I think it was about $20. Again, have all your paperwork ready, just hand it in. Always make sure you get your paperwork back. Just make sure you get the insurance. I got had insurance for nearly every country. However, I never got checked once. But the thing about it, these people are working every single day, and it's just stamping and inputting data. And I'm sure if they don't take a shining to you immediately, or they're in a bad mood, they could just basically make your trip a nightmare. In fact, they can make you go back to the other border and get it. So exit, then enter again. You know, they can be as big assholes as they want, or they'll probably might want to bribe you for money. So just always get everything done. And when you get your, whenever they give you the documentation, just take, it takes you 2 minutes, just what you should have on your phone is your VIN number, your engine number, your license plate number, all that information, so you can just double check across it, just to make sure that it's right. Because it'll cost you, a minimum will cost you a few hours at a border crossing, a maximum not being allowed out of the country, or having to go back to another border, or having to go back to an office or something to get everything sorted out, because they probably won't try and sort it out at the border for you, because they're busy and they just want to get on with their day. So yeah, I'm still only probably about 20 kilometers, 30, maybe 30 kilometers into Belize right now. And I wanted to just stop off. I've got through the border, wanted to stop off, just get my bearings. Usually do that when I get across the border, just get into the country a little bit, and then get myself organized and look at my maps. Yeah, okay, I'll stop up here. So it's just always good to just have a bit of a break once you've done all that, because it did probably take about an hour and a half, maybe an hour and 15 minutes all up, which ended up being a really good one. But you know, there are bad ones. Now, I was going to stay in Belize for a few days, maybe do some diving. And there's some really cool diving off Belize I can't remember the name of the island. But the thing about it is, once I got out of here, it was forecast for rain, and I just looked at the radar, looked at the weather, and it was like rain for 3 or 4 days. And Belize wasn't there was only a few things I wanted to do in Belize anyway. I wanted to get moving on, and I just decided, no, bugger it, I'm not going to get stuck here for 3 or 4 days and hope the weather gets better. As it turned out, it was raining. It rained just non-stop there for 3 or 4 days straight. So I actually made the right decision. I thought, well, I'm going to be able to dive elsewhere. Plus, I've already been diving once before on this trip already. Also, there's ruins there. They're not the best ruins in the whole of the area, Central America. There's far better ones everywhere else. So I thought, just get moving on. Don't get stuck somewhere with the rain. So basically, the rain was going to be a lot better, west, so inland. So I headed inland. The roads, you know, as you can see, they're unmarked. Buses seem to think that they can go pretty much in the middle of the road. It was a taste of things to come in Central America. Buses basically arseholes. No other way to put it. Bus drivers don't care about anyone's life. They just want to get there as quickly as possible. But I went out to Little Belize. I took a bit of a detour and then headed back onto the main road, and then was going to head west. I had one stop off. But you know, I went through quite a few little towns, and oh god, I mean, Belize is one of those countries. You'll witness it anywhere. You'll witness it in South America in places, but people with just, they have the speakers on the top of their cars, and it's just non-stop. Like, it's religious stuff. You know, they're a pretty religious country, and not the good type of religious, you know, just this blaring out noise all the time, and it just gets to you, you know. Trying to sleep, and then all you hear is, you know, and it's competing noises too, so there might be two or three cars all blaring out the same thing, and they were everywhere, these sort of things. So this is very English, used to be a British colony. And it shows there's a lot of quite modern sort of homes, a lot of churches and stuff like that, which doesn't bother me. I mean, churches throughout the world are probably some of the most beautiful architecture that you'll ever see, although you always wonder, you never have to wonder where all the money goes that gets donated to them. I mean, I've been through some of the poorest towns you've ever seen, and the church is glittering gold and amazing, you know. It's still beautiful, but a little bit weird. But anyway, Belize is just one of those countries, and basically once I left there, I was so glad I got out of there, to be honest. It just didn't really give me anything. It just didn't excite me at all, and a lot of people just annoying you. I don't know what that person was doing. But so the border crossings, as I say, do your research beforehand. Don't go blind to any border crossing, because you're just going to get yourself in trouble. and try to always be, have a smile. Never leave your helmet on when you're talking to any. If anyone stops you for anything, never ever leave your helmet on. I mean, the border guys at the booths and that's fine, but if they want to talk to you and ask you to get off the bike, take your helmet off. You know, you're only going to get yourself in trouble by disrespecting them. And you know, I find the most problems I had with border crossings was not the people who were the officials at the counters or anything like that. They're usually the dickheads who are, you know, they're controlling the front door and stuff like that. They just like power. A lot of them accept bribes, and they're lowly staff, but they have that power over you, so you can't argue. I had one of them that said no, Mike, because on the El Salvador border, they swapped my passport and they tore a little bit of my passport, which you just don't want to happen. And I ended up having to, I had a few, you know, one of the border crossings, I think it was Ecuador into Peru, Colombia into Ecuador. On the Ecuador side, the guy's like three and a half hours in a line, and then the guy at the front door said, sorry, that's an invalid passport, you know, and I just said, I don't care. You know, he goes, well, you won't get through, and I got the girl didn't even say a word at the counter. You know, I just refused to, he wanted me to turn around. I said, no, you know, there's nothing wrong with it. And it's one of those things too, because you can't turn around and say, it was done by one of the border things. They don't care about that. And that's why you always have to check everything, because they don't care. If somebody makes a mistake at one of the borders in their country by filling in your VIN number incorrectly or anything like that, at the next border, they don't care. It's your fault. So never get stuck with that, you know. And although insurance is going to cost you money, you just don't want to have a reason to ruin your whole holiday. As I was saying in one of the previous videos, the amount of people that don't make it, and as I said, it's not because they don't have the skill to ride a motorbike, anything like that. It's time, money, they're the two main culprits. And third would be that people are just not up to it. Not because they couldn't ride, it's just you get some really, really tough days, you know? And you've just got to basically, you've just got to put up with those days. You know, the tough days for me were all the big straight roads that, you know, you had to get from one city to another, and there was no other real option except for a big, straight, ugly, boring road. And you just pound out the miles, 10 to 12 hours, just get it over and done with. Still having breaks along the way, plenty of breaks, but just get the miles done and get to some more interesting places. So whenever I knew that I didn't have any choices, I had a big riding day. I just got it in my head, this is the way it's going to be, just get on the bike and ride. I never went fast. Like, I never thought I've got to do 140 k's an hour here. Maybe my last trip back to Buenos Aires with the big straight roads, and they were not quite nice roads, I gunned it a little bit more than normal. But I got one speeding ticket the whole way, and that was in Panama, and that was, I think, the only country with radar guns. And I was only doing 102 in a 80 zone. This is where it just started raining really badly, and I just thought, this is it. I'm going to have to get some cover. It looked pretty bad ahead. I sort of look at clouds, and if the clouds are sort of all blurred out, I know it's rain, and you sort of get to know what's going to come. If the clouds are all broken up type of thing, you might get a few big showers and stuff like that, but it's just the way I did it. Plus, you know, I had my gloves, they were already a little bit wet, and I was going to change into some other gloves, but then I don't know if I decided to do it or not. I just thought, well, let's just wear it out. It's not such a big problem, rain, if it's reasonably warm, but when it gets cold, so I think I was waiting for that car to leave, but when it gets cold, there's nothing worse than having wet gloves, or, you know, your hands just get all numb and start freezing up. So I think I stopped here for some lunch. I had a really, really nice lunch, actually. Again, look at, you see the rubbish, you know. I mean, if I owned either one of those places, I'd make sure that place was really clean. There's a little creek at the back, it was filled with rubbish as well. It's a little bit sad, but that's what happens when you get an economy that modernises a little bit, and you see that, that, you know, a lot of the stuff, like, everything's in a plastic wrap now, you know. Even though all their food here was fantastically fresh, you just see that that's the sort of thing that basically happens. you'll see that I'll show you some food. Some chicken and that. They really looked after you. But I love that sort of off the road food. And it was nice. A lot of rice and beans and stuff. So now I knew that I had, you know, I had a radar thing on my phone. And again, I just going back on my phone, I used T-Mobile because T-Mobile, I get data in every country. There wasn't one country I didn't get data in the whole trip. So if you're on AT&T or Verizon or Sprint, you basically have to turn your data off, and you can only get access while you've got Wi-Fi. So unless you want to pay an arm and a leg, so T-Mobile for me is the only way to go. Not that I endorse the company at all, because I know they're probably just a bigger bunch of assholes as anybody else. They try to pretend that they're the little guy, but they're pretty big. So yeah, I think I was here at this place here for probably 45 minutes to an hour, just waiting for the rain to sort of ease off a little bit, and then it came down again a little bit later on. And it pretty much rained all towards the end of my trip, and then as soon as I got to near San Ignacio where I was staying, it stopped, and it stopped all night. But the place where I was staying at, really nice place. But it was full of it was all water, so I couldn't ride my bike up to the cabin. So I what I did was I just decided to get out of Belize, spend one night there. I actually planned at first to spend two nights, and then I thought, nah, bugger this. I just wanted to get into Guatemala. So you always plan what's going to be your best places to go and see and stuff like that. And Guatemala and El Salvador and these sort of places. Like, I mean, El Salvador, I've dreamed of going to since I saw. I think it was Woods actor. I saw him in El Salvador, a movie. It was really cool. But yeah, it just got wet, and I just decided I'll just keep going, and I'll just go all the way. And I basically booked the hotel as I was going there, the hostel. I was a bit lucky, but pretty miserable type day. But again, when it's wet and it's warm, it doesn't really bother you anywhere near as much as when it's wet and cold. The rivers were pretty well swelled up and stuff like that, so. And the roads in Belize were pretty crappy, to be honest. They weren't that great. There's hardly any markings on any of the roads for which side of the road you're on. And I think some people just thought, well, you can just sit in the middle of the road and bikes will just get out of the way. A lot of crappy speed humps like that one. I stopped here and had a little bit of a bite to eat too. So I think it ended up taking me like to go 150 miles, 160 miles, whatever. It took me eight hours. I stopped so many times. When the rain just starts belting your visor and you just can't see anything, there's no point in continuing. I mean, it's just massively dangerous, you know. Especially with like dogs on the side of the road and stuff like that, you just gotta say, bugger it, it's gonna take me a lot longer. Let's get out of here and just get some cover somewhere. It didn't happen too often. This was my first wet, really wet day of riding the whole trip so far. I'm pretty sure it was. I had some rain on the Grand Canyon and all that, but the bike was running like a dream, and it's just not fun riding in the rain, especially when the water starts building up on the side of the road and starts sweeping onto the road. You can see there's just a ton of water everywhere, and in just at certain points it was just completely useless trying to continue. But anyway, so back to this place that I stayed at, a really cool place called Lower Dover Field Station. And so there's a lady that runs it with her husband. He wasn't there, and her son was there. She's a bit of a nutter, you know, like she's a bit of a hippie. She had some pretty interesting theories when we were having dinner. I'm a big, I get, one of my pet peeves is anecdotal evidence. So when somebody says, and you see it all over the world, but you see it in Australia, the same thing happens where, you know, a judge sentences somebody for rape for 3 months jail, And then all of a sudden we have to have mandatory minimum sentences, and they use one person as an example, and then it just ruins lives for everybody. You know, I'm not talking about rapists. Rapists can go to hell for all I can say. I can bother, but just all that sort of, people curing cancer by eating leaves or something like that. Oh, this one person. Well, that's one person, and who knows if that's true? It's just people who use that one example as some sort of proof for anything. You know, naturotherapy and all this sort of stuff. It's just a little bit weird to me, because basically, you know, the way I work is, I work on scientific reasoning, and it takes a lot more than one bit of anecdotal evidence to make a theory. It takes years and years and years and thousands of things, and you come up with a hypothesis, you test the hypothesis, you produce the results of the hypothesis. Other people test the hypothesis, get the same results over and over and over and over and over again until someone says, "Oh, this could be it. This could be something new." So yeah, but she was a really nice lady. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have gone on so much about her, but it sort of annoys me, that sort of conversation, you know. Conspiracy theorists, that sort of thing. But anyway, she runs this really nice retreat. She's a really lovely lady. She took us on a tour in the morning. There's a couple of girls there that are staying there as well. But the apartments are really, really nice. They're like little bungalows, all different colours. I imagine when it's really sunny and nice, it'll be really beautiful there. And there's a whole bunch of dogs running around. They're all friendly. And basically she lives in this, it's sort of like you go off the road, off-roading to get to there, but it's a really beautiful spot. And they've got on the property, they've got these ruins that they discovered recently, a few years back, but they're being excavated, you know, pretty carefully at the moment by archaeologists, and there's some pretty interesting findings there. And that's pretty cool, you know, you've got to say that's pretty cool. And there's some rafting and stuff like that there, but the water was running too crazy. And there's a big river down below, again, the water was running too crazy. But it's like in really dense forest, so I imagine there's more of those ruins around that will be discovered in the near future. Again, you know, riding on the road, you know, even when you're going around corners, you're really trying to keep the bike pretty much straight all the time. You know, you still got to give it a bit of a lean, but you're sitting up on the bike a lot more, a little bit feeling. You're riding a little bit more off-road style, where you're actually keeping one body, and it's good practice on bitumen to put more weight on into the center of the wheel. The tires, the Heidemau TK60s are fine. You know, they're fine in the wet. There's some theories about hydroplaning at high speed, but you know, they're talking 150 kilometers an hour through wet, and you know, I'm not going to be doing that. You know, you got to know your tires and know the limitations of them. But this is pretty much Belize. This is a main highway, and it's, you know, pretty, not a lot going on it. You know, there's not a lot of room on it for trucks and yourself. And you find after a while you work out, you know, you hold onto the bike a little bit stronger as you go past the truck, because some of them just give you a big blast of air. And even worse if it's water, big blast of water as well. It always helps to have the right riding gear. And if you're going to be going on a long trip, I suggest you invest some really good money in the gear that you're going to be using on the trip. And that means you're better if you can get, like, if you can afford the climb gear, spend the extra money, because if it's already waterproof, you don't have to put you don't have to put all this stuff over it. I'm bone dry underneath myself. You just got to zip the top up around the neck, get yourself a nice little neck warmer, and away you go. You know, the people who have to stop and put raincoats on and all that sort of stuff, really, you know, it's not the way to do it, I don't think. So I loved my climb gear, and I had the Overlander. Might not get the Overlander next time. I might get the Badlands, maybe one down for the Badlands. The Badlands is a real heavy duty and really heavy gear, you know. For a long trip, I probably wouldn't suggest it. Although if you're going to be doing a long trip and doing a lot of off-roading and crazy stuff, then yeah. But I wouldn't want to be riding in the Badlands gear in extremely hot weather, because I mean, for me, I just fry with it. So yeah, so today wasn't a long journey, but it took me 8 hours. But I left pretty early in the morning. It took me 8 hours from go to work. Left early in the morning. You know, luckily I got through the border fairly quickly. As you find out later on, borders can take 2 to 3 hours, especially in Central America. South America, you know, I got the worst one in on the Colombia-Ecuador border, but that was a bit of an anomaly, and most of them were pretty good, you know, especially Argentina, Chile, just in and out fairly quickly, unless there was a crowd and then you had to wait. There's nothing worse than walking in and seeing a line of 20, 30 people, especially when it looks like the place is pretty empty. But again, you know, I just always balanced my brain and said, hey, it's going to be 2 or 3 hours at the border. Anything less than that is a bonus, you know. And that's the best way to approach it. Just be happy and just take your time. I only got really pissed off once, and that was the Colombia-Ecuador border, because everyone was just... there was hardly anyone working. There was hundreds and hundreds of people in the line and no one cared. I think there was one other crossing on border, on the Peru border. I think the border into Peru. Ecuador, Peru. Actually, I think the border out of Peru was a pretty slow one as well. Big lines of people. And this is where you go into the Lower David place. But and you'll see some pictures here of the joint. I took some at night and some in the morning. That was heading in there to the... So there's the little houses. I didn't stay in that one. I stayed in one with a shower. That's one of the other ones there. Yeah, all water, all self-contained, comfortable beds. That was a community shower there. That's the lady. I think her name was Madeline. She was a really, really sweet lady. There's the office up the back there. That's another one of the bungalows. That's like a community room with a pool table. It was covered up. Again, that's the office there. They also sell wine and stuff like that. There's a bunch of dogs, but they've got the hibiscus trees, and her son makes all this wine. He was a nice guy. Son makes this wine, and makes red hibiscus, red wine out of the hibiscus. It's pretty nice, pretty sweet, but it's really, really nice. That was in the morning. So I went on a bit of a walk in the morning with a really interesting walk. She knows her stuff, the history and stuff like that. So it was a really nice walk, and it was like really dense. You can see as you go over, you can see there's some pasture land there, but it was pretty dense, and there's a dog in the water. There's some of the ruins that they've excavated so far, and they believe there's some sort of temple and some sort of, they think there had to be someone important living there, because they had a temple and then they had tombs as well. Can't really see any of the ruins there, but they're underneath there. I'm not sure what that was. I think she explained it to me, what it could have been. There are the girls that were staying there as well. So I only stayed one night, and I basically got left late because I didn't have a long trip into Flores in Guatemala the next day. So I just left, I think I left about 10, 11 a.m. and got into where I was going at about 2 or 3 p.m. So it was fine. That's a pretty poor picture of the river there. That's where the archaeologists are working. There's all these little ruins everywhere, and you know, I'm sure they sort of know which ones are important. The dogs came with us, and they're pretty cool as well. But it's really interesting then listening to her, and it'd be lovely to stay there with some nice weather and do some canoeing and some kayaking and stuff like that on the rivers. It'd be pretty cool. It's a really beautiful place. And there's a bit of a plantation, a hibiscus plantation as well. It's one of these really, really old trees that's been there for years. There's some steps up, yeah. But anyway, questions or comments below, guys. Thank you.